Right there. Oh, here
we go.
Yeah, I got a good
ball.
I know, we said lower. Nice to see you. Hi. So,
this is John Paul's best friend right here.
Oh, right here.
What are you doing there?
I'll be done. Hi, fellas. Hi, fellas. Thank you. Thank you. My father, David. See over here.
Right here, either way. Ladies and gentlemen, thank all of you. We're sorry. we're a little bit late. I just mentioned a few moments ago, I've never been in a more ecumenical audience than this great audience of Democrats and Republicans and Independents, but first of all, Americans. Thank all of you for coming out to welcome Senator Bob Dole. Let's give him a big round of applause. We're going to have a short program, but first I'd like to introduce the best of the best, the volunteers, the newest chapter in America, the biggest chapter of inaugural City Year volunteers ever in the history of that great organization. City Year, y'all stand up. Thank you very, very much. Thank you. Thank all of you. Governor Huckabee and Congressman Hammersmith, Senator Dole, ladies and gentlemen, just a word, if I might say, about the University of Arkansas Clinton School of Public Service. One year from now, we will be receiving our first class, the inaugural class for the Clinton School of Public Service. This will be the only school in America that will give a master's degree in the field of public service. Many schools, public administration, public finance, public policy, yes, this will be the only school that will give a master's degree in the field of public service. We think it's going to be something that Arkansas is going to be very, very proud to have ownership of and to be a partner with. Secondly, we'd like to state about our school that we have three parents of this school, just so you will know, because we're really now in putting the face on the Clinton School. Our first parent is going to be the University of Arkansas at Little Rock, the University of Arkansas Medical Science Campus, and the University of Arkansas in Fayetteville. And we are honored today to have with the president of the University of Arkansas, Dr. Alan Sugg here. Alan, would you please stand, and we appreciate you. Thank you very much. We have also members of the Board of Trustees, several members of the Board of Trustees of the University. In addition to that, we have several members of our legislature who are here, and we are honored to have each and every person here. Also, to say a few words of thanks to all of the sponsors who are making this possible. The Regions Bank helped us put on a reception for Senator Dole just a little bit a few minutes ago down at the Choctaw Building. The Choctaw Building that you have seen right next to the Presidential Library is the old 1899 train station that some of you used to eat spaghetti in. It was the spaghetti warehouse, and the old spaghetti warehouse and the 1899 Choctaw Station, thanks to the Sturgis Foundation gift of $4 million, has restored and resurrected this wonderful classical building to a building of beauty and one that is going to house the Clinton School of Public Service. What an exciting time this is for all of us. What an exciting time, right almost on the eve of the opening of the Presidential Library, November 18th. And we hope that you will all participate in that week. All of the former presidents of our country will be here. Distinguished world leaders will be here for that event. And it's going to be a 3 or 4 day period like our state has never seen before. I would like, if I could today, to have, as we say, a special privilege, a point of personal privilege, so to speak, Senator Dole, a point of personal privilege to introduce one of my very closest and dearest friends, a man that I had the privilege of going to Congress with as a freshman in 1967. Someone, and I just told some of Senator Dole's staff, let me introduce them if I could. Tiffany Williams. Tiffany, where are you? You came down. There's Tiffany. She rode down with us. She's one of the young lawyers, and she's one of the young lawyers in Senator Dole's firm. Then we, in Washington, Rhonda Birdle, I believe that is the correct way to pronounce that. Thank you, Rhonda. And I want to show his bipartisan spirit today. Senator Dole made sure that these two young ladies are young Democrats. So we appreciate them being on Senator Dole's plane. And we could not have put this together without the very, very wonderful cooperation and support of Lana DeLeo, I believe
DeLeo.
DeLeo. And we appreciate Lana being here. Lana is from Russia. This is her fifth year in this country, and this is her first visit to the state of Arkansas. And we welcome his wonderful staff being here. Let me introduce my friend and your friend. I just told the staff a while ago that sitting down at the Choctaw building, I said, you can't drive 5 miles in Arkansas without being on a stretch of highway named the John Paul Hammersmith Highway. Let us introduce our friend, Congressman John Paul Hammersmith. John Paul.
Thank you, David. You know, it's really an honor to be sitting here on this podium with three very, very distinguished public servants. They all have records of their own that are absolutely outstanding in serving the people and serving our country. I was pleased to get introduced by David Pryor because we're longtime friends. As he said, we served in the House together before he went on to the upper body. I refer to him as Congressman, Governor, Senator, now Dean David Pryor. You need to see David's office out there. It doesn't have the furniture in it yet, but he has a prime spot, and I know he's going to do a great job out there. Also, the reason we're here, of course, is because Senator Bob Dole's here. And he's also a longtime personal friend and one I served 2 years in the House with before he went on to the Senate.
Yeah, for Saturday.
So we're delighted that he's with us today. My real job is to make an introduction, but I don't need to make an introduction to this gathering, so I want to make a presentation. I want to present one of the greatest governors in the nation, Governor Mike Huckabee.
All right.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. I want you to know how difficult it was to ask you to be seated and quit that, because I was really wanting to say, please, continue. I don't get that very often. It is an honor and a joy to be here. I have the privilege of welcoming Senator Dole to Arkansas officially, and before he leaves today, it will also be our joy to send with him, and here it is, an Arkansas Traveler Certificate commemorating his official honorary citizenship in the state of Arkansas, which we are happy to present to him today with our thanks for his coming and being the inaugural speaker at the Clinton School. I wanted to just express a simple thought today that I hope I can convey. When I was asked to do this, it was an incredible honor, and I was thrilled for this reason, because I truly do love Bob Dole as a human being. Now, let me tell you why. When I first ran, there weren't that many people that really were out there pitching for me. A whole lot of people had no thought I would win. By the way, they were right that first time. But it amazed me that one of the people who believed in me and was willing to come from Washington and invest his time, when every candidate on the Republican ticket in America would love to have had him, a person who did come to campaign for me and stand with me and encourage me, was Senator Bob Dole. Now, there was nothing in it for him. There was nothing in it for him. If he'd asked around his friends and said, is there any reason for I should get on there and help that kid in Arkansas, they'd have said, not a chance. Forget it. Spend your time where it can be of value. But he came. And it was more than that he came and helped me raise funds and brought attention. He gave me an encouragement that I'll never in my life forget, as long as I live. This is a man that all of us know is a true American hero. It's his image that really ought to be on our kids' walls instead of entertainment figures and celebrities from Hollywood or the music business, because he truly is an American hero, the real deal, the real thing, in his entire life of public service. But it was not just that he came, but an incident happened in our event in Bella Vista, Arkansas, that I'll also never forget, and it made an incredible impression on me. As we were getting in the car and hurrying to the airport for the next event, knowing that we were behind schedule, needing to get on, an elderly gentleman approached the car and handed the senator an envelope, a thick envelope with lots of information. And he said, Senator, I have some thoughts here on how we can fix the federal deficit. I wanted to hand this to you. I thought maybe it'd come of some use. You know, I would have expected, honestly, thank you, and put it in his pocket, hand it to the aide who was in the front seat. And instead, when the aide turned around and said, Senator, you may take that from me and I'll deal with it. Nice way to say, I'll toss that later. The senator looked up and he says, no, son, I'd like to keep that. You know, you may not realize it, but that gentleman right there may have an answer, and by gosh, we certainly don't have one in Washington right now. Here's what it told me. In the quiet privacy of that automobile, when no one really would have been noticing, Bob Dole saw that gentleman as an American citizen that deserved the respect of his attention. I want to tell you, there aren't that many public servants who are at his stature who never, ever have forgotten where he started. And I think that's one of the reasons that he's such an appropriate figure to be here today to talk about true public service, because he exemplifies it in every single thing that he does. It is now my pleasure to turn the program back over to a person who in Arkansas absolutely exemplifies public service. And he has throughout his career. I've said it doesn't matter whether a person in Arkansas is a Democrat or a Republican. They love David Pryor. Every politician longs to have the affection that is given to David Pryor. None of us have it. We just wish we did. But he's deserved it. He's earned it. And his entire life, he will certainly have mine. Senator David Pryor will come to introduce Senator Dole today.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Our thoughts and prayers today are with President Bill Clinton. On Saturday evening, Senator Dole, I had the privilege of talking with President Clinton. And by the way, he's ready to get on out on the trail. He's restless, but he wanted, of course, to have his best wishes extended to you on your visit. It was back in May, I believe, when President Clinton went to Kansas, to the University of Kansas, to make the inaugural address or to open the Bob Dole Institute of Politics there at the University of Kansas. And so we're so honored today that he could come and be a part of the opening salvo, you might say, of the Clinton School of Public Service. Bob Dole is truly the pride of Russell, Kansas, and he is the favorite son of the Sunflower State. As a legislator, in my opinion, he was unmatched. He was unmatched, John Paul, in his unique skills. He had a canny sense of timing. He had a tenacious devotion to public service, and he had Governor Huckabee a remarkable sense of humor. After a very distinguished military career, wounded, ultimately rehabilitated, highly decorated, Bob Dole became a state legislator. I say this especially for the benefit of the young men and women in this room this afternoon. He became a member of the Kansas State Legislature at age 28. In 1974, he was his party's nominee for vice president. 1996, his party once again reached out and called upon Bob Dole to ask him and to seek the opportunity for him to become the party's standard bearer as a candidate for president of the United States. Senator Bob Dole's impact and his footprints, his very deep footprints, I think, on the America's political and economic landscape are going to be seen and felt for many, many generations to come. For a part of his journey and his great journey, I had the high privilege of participating in that journey as a colleague, hopefully as a friend, serving with this very, very remarkable man from Kansas. I had that privilege for 18 years. When a decision was made to have this inaugural lecture, University of Arkansas Clinton School of Public Service, the name that first came up, in fact, the only name ever mentioned for this opportunity, was Bob Dole of Kansas, one whose name in America has been for many, many years synonymous with the best of public service. Today, we want to show him our thanks. We also want to show him our respect, and we want to show him an Arkansas welcome, Senator Bob Dole.
All right. Thanks, David. I'm Paul. Thank you. Thanks for coming. Thank you. Thank you very much. I think I'm wired here, so I can. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. I'm all wired here. I feel a little like winning the trip. Don't say anything. Well, I'm very honored to be here, and when President Clinton was going in the hospital, I sent him an email. I said, if you need any Republican blood, I said, you got most of it in 96, but I'll send you a pint or two. So, I haven't heard back, but he's recovering, so I know it must have been Republican blood that did the trick. But in any event, as David pointed out, we're all friends up here. We all see these great things about each other, and part of them are true, and part of them are still, we just can't get this out of our system. But people wonder about Bob Dole and Bill Clinton. Now, what do they have in common? Well, not much. I mean, it's more fun winning than losing. But as I'll say in my speech, I think we considered each other as opponents and not enemies in 1996. I mean, we weren't going to go out until somebody dropped and the survivor said, I win. And Clinton was the winner, and I had four or five choices, go off in a corner and pout and say life isn't fair and da-da-da, or I could get up and try to do something else with my life. And at my young age, I thought surely I should do something else. I remember one of my bumper strips in 96 was Dole in 96. Somebody in the other camp put Dole is 96. Pretty good thinking at that. But so what do you do when you're in public life as long as I was? And suddenly I left the Senate voluntarily on June the 11th, 1996, thinking the American people want to see some politician come along who willing to give up something instead of trying to get more and more and more. So I decided that I would step down as majority leader and a senator from Kansas and roll the dice and say, here it is. I knew I was behind. I knew it was going to be tough catching Clinton. But I thought this was our chance to just sort of get away from Washington. And I did it. A lot of people didn't apparently know that I did it. It didn't make any difference to them, but I think I made the right decision. There comes a time, as David knows and John Paul knows, a time to leave. It's so hard to leave in politics. When you've been there year after year, term after term, and things just pile up, souvenirs and
plaques and all that stuff. You keep saying, I'm just going to run until I die and let somebody else worry about it. And I think I can name four or five who probably adopted that. It's just too hard to pack. So you just keep on running. You know, I'll do it next time. But anyway, it's when I got out of politics, I didn't know quite what to do. I made a couple of commercials. I didn't bring any samples. It's hard to carry Pepsi around in your pocket, you know, but since Britney Spears was mentioned somewhere, I don't know the other place about her long marriage, I was asked to be in a commercial with Britney Spears, and this was 3 or 4 or 5 years ago, and I had to go to L.A. from Washington, D.C., and when I got there, Britney was gone, but the dog was there, Ted. And Ted was, I was seated where David is, and Ted was at my left side, and we were watching Britney on television. Now, at my age, I wasn't certain what was happening on television. But when the dog started to bark, I was supposed to lean over and say, easy, boy. And I got it right on the second time. And I got a year's free Pepsi, and she got $10 million. And I got about 5 dirty old man letters from around the country. And I said, I wasn't barking, it was a dog that's barking. I was just watching television. But a couple of things we did, we put together, compiled a couple of books. I didn't write the books, a compilation of, one was called Great Political Wit, and the subtitle was Laughing Almost All the Way to the White House. And it was a good book. We cleared it with the Kennedy family, the Bush family. It was all good, clean stuff, and became a bestseller. And I think you probably all heard the line that I don't know if these are all true or not, but one was attributed to Winston Churchill, who seated at a big dinner one night. The lady asked her, and they got in a big, big fight back and forth, verbal fight, back and forth, right in each other's face. And she finally said, Winston, if you were my husband, I would poison your coffee. Said, if you were my wife, I would drink it. It's an old story, but it's a good story. Doesn't have to be coffee, it can be Pepsi. So we had a lot of those, we had a lot of fun. Then we decided, and I think David would agree, and John Paul, who served in Congress, I never saw a book on presidential humor. On what presidents had, foreign policy, foreign policy, economic policy, but you ever see a book written about presidential humor? So three fellows that worked for me decided to try to give it a, you know, give it a try. We wanted to pick the top 10 presidents in order, like the Letterman top 10. And we set about it, and some of you looking up here, I didn't know all the presidents, you know, I didn't quite know them all. I see some looking up here. The ones I didn't know, Senator Thurman knew. And he'd been an intern for Jefferson, met Washington several times, and so he gets a lot of credit in the book. And we went over and over and over, and we went back to George Washington. Of course, they didn't have TV, the late night show, all this stuff. And went way up to the present time, and it was the election of 2000, and they were still counting or not counting, depending on your point of view, votes in Florida. But we had to get her book out. So we had to add one chapter. It was called Waiting in the Wings. It was all the Bush humor and Gore humor. And fortunately, we were able to get it all on one page, so it didn't hold up the printing very long. Number one, out of, and believe me, there was end up, Dave, we didn't plan it. There were 5 Democrats and 5 Republicans. Number one was Abraham Lincoln. If you think about Lincoln and the times, and the, some people describe the tragic-looking figure, all the personal tragedy, the Civil War, all that everything was piled up on him, he almost needed a crutch to get through each day. He was speaking one day, and a lady jumped up and said, "Mr. President, you're two-faced." He said, "Think I had another one, I'd use the one I have." You know, this is not bad for the 1800s, yeah, 1860. And Ronald Reagan, God bless him, whether you're Democrat or Republican, you always had a little twinkle in his eye, and you forget on the way to the Oval Office what you're going there for, particularly after you rolled out a few jelly beans. You couldn't remember your name. But he walked into a group like this one day, and he said, "Boy, have I been getting a lot of flack lately since I ordered those B-1s. He said, "How was I to know they're airplanes?" He said, "I thought they were vitamins for the troops." Typical Reagan, self-deprecating humor, just endeared him to millions of people, Republicans, Democrats, and Independents. And we'll miss him. And just one other. I think Kennedy and Reagan are obviously the best. They have the best timing, the best whatever it is, delivery. But Calvin Coolidge. I don't imagine many people in this room remember Calvin Coolidge. No. How many people have heard of Calvin Coolidge? Oh, three. Well, that's all right. Four with me. Well, he never said anything. Might be a good guy to have speak it, you know, but he says as much now as he did when he was alive. So he could be a speaker. But he was known as Silent Cal. He'd have a press conference, he'd say, "Question number one, no comment. Number two, no comment. Three, four, five, no comment." Then he finished, "Now don't quote me on anything." And he was at a big White House dinner one night, and the senator's wife was there, and she leaned over about halfway through the dinner and said, "Mr. President, I bet my husband $20 I could get you to say three words." He said, "You lose." That was the end of it. So we had five Democrats and five Republicans. It's a pretty good book called Great Presidential Wit, and the subtitle is, "I Wish I Was in This Book." You know, I keep driving by the White House all during the time Clinton was, I kept thinking maybe a recount, you know, maybe something would happen. So I finally came here to finally admit that I lost in 96. That's why I'm here today. To see the library, see the conference. And President Clinton and I have done some things together since 96. He asked me to go to the Balkans because they had lost about 30,000 people disappeared off the face of the earth. And they were Bosniaks, and they were Serbs, and they were Croats, and later Kosovars. And nobody knew what happened. So I was asked by Secretary Albright and the President to head a commission. And we go over there, and we'd always meet with the mothers. It's always been my theory in all these conflicts, the mothers really pay the price. It's their son, it's their husband, it's their son-in-law, it's their daughter anymore, and their they always pay the price. I discovered a letter about 6 months ago from my mother. I never knew I had. Written to me right after church, I was wounded in Italy. And it's formed the basis of a book which will come out next April 14, 2005, 60 years after I was wounded in Italy, just talking about my 5 years of recovery in hopes it'll be an inspiration to other people with disabilities and other people who get a little older who think life is over. Yeah, I hope it's, you know, it's going to be an inspiration. But my mother sort of inspired it. So we would always talk to the mothers. And they go around the room, and keep in mind, these are mothers in these countries. All they had was a dress on their back. And they would tell us about what happened. There was a knock at the door. They dragged their son or dragged their husband. They were later tortured or starved and executed and put in mass graves, something we said would never happen after World War II. But happened, much smaller graves, 10, 20, 30, 40, 50. Yes, it happened in Serbia. It happened in Croatia, mostly in Bosnia, then later in Kosovo. And I'll tell you just about one story. My last meeting before I left the commission. There were five countries. We had a small budget. Nobody heard of it. No reason you should. But it sort of fits into the theme of the day. I met with a family in Pristina. There was a grandmother, the mother, the daughter-in-law, a couple other relatives, and there were one man, one uncle. And they'd come to meet with me, tell me about this awful tragedy, which could have been repeated in Serbia, Croatia, and mostly in Bosnia, because that's where most of it happened. She was telling me through the interpreter all the things that had happened. On May 9, 1999, there was a knock at the door. Outside, there were soldiers. Inside were 25 people. 25 people in a little tiny house, probably about the size of this stage, with a little to eat, not a weapon in sight, not a firearm. They were just trying to hope this whole thing would go away. All the men were ordered to stay. The women were ordered out. There were 11 men stayed, 14 women went outside. 2 days later, they were permitted to go back. And all they found were bloodstains. Bloodstains. And keep in mind, these were good people. There were two engineers. There were two students, young people like we have in the audience today. And they were there with their mother with tears. We were all crying. And that could be repeated today and, you know, for the last 100 years. But you know what she said to me, which I think makes the point of why I'm here today? She didn't know whether Bob Dole was a Democrat or Republican. It didn't make any difference. But you know what she knew? That I was an American. And she said, because I was there and I represented America, she was certain we were going to find her husband and her sons and all the other relatives. That's the credibility we have at nearly every place in the world. It's not presidents and governors and senators and congressmen that people think of. They think of you. People in this audience, they don't know your politics. They don't know what you do. But they know you do a lot of good things. You've got a big heart and you're compassionate if you're an American. And here she is, this tears streaming down her cheek saying, I know you're going to find my husband. I know you're going to find my sons. Because you're an American. Well, it hasn't happened yet. I checked about 2 months ago. There's still a few people in Serb jails, but it's very unlikely they'll ever be found. If you recall Vietnam and how we tried to bring closure to the families in Arkansas and Kansas and all across America by trying to identify the remains, and we used DNA techniques, and we identified so far about 10,000 out of 30,000, so at least the mothers and the children would know that these remains were my son or my father or my husband, and it would bring closure. Now, that's what America is really all about. Oh, I believe in a two-party system, and I believe in competition, and I believe in campaigns, and sometimes politics isn't beanball. But in the end, the American people speak. And I can do that in a while. And I'm not talking about today's election. I didn't disappoint anybody in the media, but I didn't come here to talk about who's going to win or lose. I'll be happy to do that afterwards, but but not now. Governor Huckabee's been a friend of mine, and John Paul and David and I worked together. I only think of one time when I think David was pretty upset with me, because I think I was taking issue with some of Clinton's programs as a leader. They don't elect nonpartisan leaders. George Mitchell wasn't, I wasn't. We were good friends. And they said, David Pryor's coming to the floor. I said, uh-oh, get me out of here. Because he defended President Clinton on the floor, did it very well. And Barbara, part of that team. And now Mark, there's still a Mark, Pryor and a Dole there, so I'm things are going great shape in the United States Senate. They're keeping an eye on the rest of them. Kansas and Arkansas, you know, actually three-fourths of Arkansas is Kansas. No. Six out of eight letters, that isn't bad. So I feel at home here. and the traditions in Arkansas and Kansas and the philosophy were pretty independent people. In our little hometown, used to be, and I think it's pretty much the same. When I first ran for the state legislature, I went down to the courthouse and saw, I discovered there were more Republicans than Democrats, so I became a committed Republican. But it didn't make much difference in our little town of Russell. If your name was Ben Jones or Betty something and you were a nice person, you're probably going to get elected. And what, you know, in the local level, they didn't have that strong partisan feeling. Maybe at the federal level, but not at the local level. So I've thought a lot about what I ought to say today. I know it's a warm-up for the Razorbacks game, and I think you're going to win big tonight to make up for whatever happened. I don't know what happened last week, but it seemed like something didn't happen. Somebody fumbled, and I've done that a lot, so I feel sorry for the guy. That won't happen tonight. I come from the land of the Jayhawk. You may not know the origins of the term, but back in the years before the Civil War, anti-slavery Kansans, who were dubbed Jayhawks, did battle with pro-slavery Missourians known as bushwhackers. And David has assured me there would be no bushwhacking here today. Like all of you, my thoughts in the last couple of weeks have been with President Clinton, and I understand he's doing very well. He's getting anxious to get back on the trail. He loves to get out and mix with people. That was his strength. And I'm certain he's going to be back there very soon doing all he can for John Kerry and others. David mentioned that President Clinton was kind enough to come to the University of Kansas. We had a totally sold-out crowd in the heat of summer, and we don't have air conditioning at Allen Fieldhouse. And it was hot. I thought I was going to faint. And President Clinton started in the prepared remarks, and about page five, I could see that book closing. It was hot. So he went back and gave the speech he knew quite well and did a great job, and the students loved it and the faculty. Then he went by and visited our Dole Institute of Politics. I don't qualify for a library, but we do have a little Institute of Politics. And so I'm happy to reciprocate in some small way. I never get to give an inaugural address, so I'm glad to be able to give an inaugural address here today. So I did have a pretty good one written for 1996. And I remember in January of 97, President Clinton presented me with the highest civilian award, the Medal of Freedom. And I got up and I said, pretending that I'd just been elected. I said, I, Robert J. Dole, do solemnly swear. Oop. Wrong speech. And of course, Clinton almost broke up laughing at Al Gore. But I believe in what W.C. Fields once said. If at first you don't succeed, try again, then give up. No use being a damn fool about it. So I finally gave up. Not on the country, but on every guy. I used to tell Elizabeth, just wait a while. We're going to get a bigger place. And I always thought it was going to be 1600 Pennsylvania. But after the last one, I said, no, I can't wait any longer. We better increase whatever we have, which is what we've done. But anyway, most of you recall the famous footage of JFK White House when this young guy from Arkansas went through and met President Kennedy. And one day they go on to live in the same house. I come from a somewhat different political tradition. I arrived in Washington in January 1961, just as my hero, President Eisenhower, was leaving. And he was preparing to leave the nation's capital after 8 years in the Oval Office. And let me just say an aside there. Everybody loved Eisenhower. A lot of people didn't agree with him on politics, but they liked the guy. And one of the things he did that I always remembered, he invited all of us in the freshman class, Democrats and Republicans, to come to Camp David, where he took us on a two-hour tour of the Gettysburg battlefield. Gave us lunch and put us back on the bus, and we've never forgotten it. That was really our first experience, some of us coming from small towns, going to Washington, D.C., and here a very popular president was taking us down to the farm and giving us all this great view. I take pride in my Kansas roots. I wouldn't be here today if the people of Russell hadn't rallied to support me after the war. And that probably helps me explain my belief that the greatness of America lies not in the power of their government, but in the goodness of her people. At the same time, I owe my life to doctors, including nurses and many others in Army and VA hospitals. Later on, I had like maybe one or two in this room helping the GI Bill. We didn't have any money. And along came this GI Bill. How many World War II veterans are in the audience? Please stand right now. Please stand. Yeah. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you. Now, these men and women made it possible for us to be here today. They made sacrifices we don't even know about because they don't talk about it. They're quiet heroes. We built this great memorial in Washington, D.C., and the beauty of it is that only 6% came from the federal government. The rest came from money from people like you all across America, 600,000 donors. And you owe it to your father or your grandfather to make sure he gets there in time to see it. There are only 14 World War II vets still serving in Congress, and I invited them down to the memorial the day before it opened publicly. And these are hardened old guys like Frank Lautenberg, Ted Stevens, Dan Inouye, Fritz Hollings. And you could tell when they walked into that big, dignified, wonderful memorial, they all had the same reaction, like this. They're all sort of reflecting back in their younger days and where they were and what they did, and it made them feel good. And I think the story you take away from that memorial is not, it's pretty simple. It's been going on since before the Revolutionary War. That sometime in your life you may be called upon to make a sacrifice for your country to preserve liberty and freedom. That's all this memorial is about. And you owe it to yourself to see it. That's one time America was united. Tom Brokaw called us the greatest generation. The greatest generation weren't just those of us in uniform. You can't all wear a uniform. We had farmers and shopkeepers and preachers and college presidents and everybody else keeping everything going. And we were the greatest generation, but I think now that title has been transferred and it's been earned by the young men and women in Afghanistan and Iraq and Korea serving us around the world to protect liberty and freedom. They're the greatest generation. But the point I've been trying to make, I've never confused self-reliance with selfishness. Nor have been reluctant to use federal authority where moral authority demanded it. And let me give you one example, one that may have special relevance here. I think of two school buses. In 1957, the attention of the nation was riveted on Central High here in Little Rock. But 3 years earlier, it was a school district in Topeka, Kansas, that gave rise to the case of Brown versus Topeka School Board and the undoing of the legal segregation in America. Now fast forward a decade to March 1965. It is a few days after civil rights demonstrators in Selma have been beaten senseless for demanding federal voting rights legislation. I was in the House chamber that night when President Lyndon Johnson echoed their demand and proclaimed with unmistakable sincerity, "We shall overcome." I was a conservative Republican from Kansas. President Johnson, a liberal Democrat from Texas. We disagreed more often than we agreed, but we were one as one in defining the issue of our times for a simple reason. No first-class democracy can tolerate second-class citizens. And I mention this not to wallow in nostalgia, but to remind the young people in today's audience that there really was a time in Washington, D.C. when political differences didn't get in the way of personal friendships. And the same is true with David and Paul. Now, age may not bestow wisdom, may bother your hip. A few other things bothers mine. But it carries privileges. Like all of us World War II vets, we can tell any story we want. We've all become big heroes. I held them all 5,000 all by myself. There's nobody around to contradict us anymore. We've gone from 16.5 million to less than 5. We've become the disappearing generation. But boy, I've heard some tall ones the last few months. I tell you. But, it's, you know, that's the way it goes. We have these rights and privileges. And it carries with it a right to remember. And perhaps the silver their perspectives comes with experience. When I reflect on my 35 and a half years in Washington, I don't think first of the legislative battles won or lost, but I think of friendships forged for life. Thomas Jefferson said that a friendship is precious, not only in the shade, but in the sunshine of life. And thanks to a benevolent arrangement of things, the greater part of life is sunshine. So some of us who are a little older think of that. And much of the sunshine in my life stems from the people in both parties who taught me many things. Among them, that words exchanged in the heat of a campaign need not impair close friendships. Indeed, that they can and must be set aside in order to realize what is best for America. Take President Clinton and I. In recent years, we have worked closely to address the needs of refugees and war-torn families in the former Yugoslavia. After 9/11, we co-chaired the Families of Freedom campaign to provide scholarships to every single child who lost a parent or provider on that terrible day. And we raised, well, we didn't, but a lot of people helped put together $125 million. And for a while, we were even television pundits. The only act in history of 60 Minutes to stop the stopwatch. And when our contract expired, there was no talk of extension. Maybe a job there now, come to think of it. But anyway, and though our votes are likely to cancel out each other this November, our mutual respect transcends party loyalties. In 1996, he was my opponent. He was my opponent, not my enemy. As I said, there's a difference. As it happened, I may not have entered politics, certainly never run for the Senate, if it were not for a Democrat named Philip Hart. I first met Phil Hart at Percy Jones Hospital in Battle Creek, Michigan. I was there recovering from my war injuries, so was Dan Inouye, Senator Inouye from Hawaii, who today, I think this year, running probably unopposed. Phil was less severely wounded than Dan and myself, and he ran errands for the rest of us from the morning to night. And all three of us talked about the future. We were 20-some years old, 21, 22. Phil said he regarded politics as an opportunity to make a more humane life for everybody. I remembered Phil's advice in the spring of 1969, April 14. It was the 24th anniversary of the day I was wounded in Italy. It was also the occasion for my first floor speech in the Senate. In those days, you had to wait a while before you spoke, before you gave what you call a maiden speech. And for as long as I was in the Senate, I chose to talk about the challenges faced by disabled Americans. I did it every April 14, or close thereby. And I didn't just talk. With the help of David and John Paul in the House and many, many others of both sides of the political aisle, we took a page out of Phil Hart's book. He was the conscience of the Senate. If you go back to Washington now, you visit the Hart Building, named after Phil Hart. I will always remember the wheelchairs on the White House lawn when the first President Bush signed the Americans with Disabilities Act into law more than a decade ago. It's a sight you'll never forget. People on gurneys and with their dogs and wheelchairs, 3,000. To sign the Americans with Disabilities Act was a long, long overdue. You know the days when people in wheelchairs would roll up to a restaurant and there was a curb 6-8 inches high? They might as well have been in some other country. They're good consumers. There are 40 million of us. And so everything is changing. We're not there yet. We're working on it. We're always a work in progress. I never forget, and I thought I was going to be in the minority all the time I was in Congress. I'll never forget 1991 when Senator Baker called me and said, you're going to be the new chairman of the Senate Finance Committee, which writes the tax laws and health laws and trade laws. I said, okay, Howard, but who's going to tell Russell Long? Russell had been a senator, the chairman of the committee for 17 years. The first time we had a vote in that committee, we went down to roll call and said, Mr. Chairman, he voted aye. He forgot I was the chairman. But we were good friends, and we got along fine after that. And there's a vast difference, as David knows, between serving the minority and the majority. They're all great opportunities, don't mistake me. But in the majority, whether it's a Democrat or Republican majority, you have an obligation to provide leadership. And right now in the Senate with 51 to 49, you know, it's like Senator Baker once said, like dealing with a wet noodle. Or like herding cats. It's tough. But that's the way it goes. You soon have to realize that you've got the responsibility. And finally, let me say that I don't know what's going to happen, but I'm not here to talk about that. But I figured out for one party to have uninterrupted control of the Senate is to be impatient, I think the Democrats are ought to hear it. If it goes like it did before, how long we were out, the Democrats will be back in control in 2018. About the time that many of this school's graduates will be ready to follow the footsteps of its namesake. I just hope you don't have to grapple with Social Security. That's the toughest issue I ever had in politics. And I worked out a compromise with a Democrat. Compromise is a good word. Do a lot of it. I remember Ronald Reagan saying, give me 80% to 90%, I'll get the rest later. And in 1983, when Social Security was going belly up, I worked with Pat Moynihan. And we were able to put it together because new 30 million people weren't going to get their checks on time. And we did it. And nobody liked it. Tip O'Neill didn't like it. Ronald Reagan didn't like it. But we finally got enough votes for it, so it brought a pretty good bill. If nobody liked it, everybody got to give a little contribution. And Social Security is still solvent, going to be solvent through the year 2017. And I don't think they're going to fix it much before. That's like backing into a buzzsaw. And you put it off as long as you can. So we belong to different parties. Maybe had different solutions. But we did prefer solutions to sound bites. We understood that the lead is to choose. Leadership does not mean total victory, as I said about Ronald Reagan. But at its best, the Senate is a collegial body where principled pragmatists never confuse civility with weakness or compromise with surrender. I often disagreed with the leaders who sat across the aisle from me. If there never was a time when we distrusted each other, or we might question the other side's ideas, but rarely its motives and never its patriotism. Moreover, all of the cynicism bred by modern campaigning, the wedge issues and the pointed fingers and poison pens, conviction still triumphs expediency. And let me give you a case in point. Back in March 1995, we're trying to get a balanced budget amendment, and I was a majority leader. And we had a small margin, 53 to 47, and we needed 66 votes. The House, for the first time in 40 years, had a Republican House, and we had this agenda come to the Senate, the balanced budget amendment. President Clinton didn't think much of the idea and was doing his best to defeat it. Needless to say, his best was pretty good. But even so, we were able to get 14 Senate Democrats to support the amendment. That meant we'd need all 53 Republicans and 14 Democrats to give you 67 votes. And then this shocker came to me. We were on the very brink of success when Senator Mark Hatfield, a Republican, came to me and said he planned to vote no. That means I don't have two-thirds. And what did he say? He said, let me resign from the Senate today. Then there'll be 99 senators. Then you only need 66 to 33 for two-thirds. I said, no way. No way, Mark. I appreciate that, but there'll be a vote next week, and you'll be on my side. I rejected his proposal on the spot. I must say some of my Republican colleagues asked for his resignation, but I respect any senator's right to vote his conscience. And it was clear that that was something for him as a very matter of principle. I even remember people praying with me about the balanced budget amendment, but we couldn't even move him with prayer. So I don't know what I was trying to move him with. But after you get over the hurt of losing, you go on to something else. Abraham Lincoln knew political rejection, poverty, and the death in the years before his presidency. Theodore Roosevelt lost both his wife and his mother to illness in the same terrible day. Polio robbed Franklin and Roosevelt of the use of his legs, but if it weakened his muscles, it strengthened his character. And out of the crucible of his own suffering emerged a different man, more sensitive, more compassionate, more inspiring. No wonder it was said in the bleak 30s that it took a man on crutches to teach a crippled nation how to walk again. One thing you learn quickly in the political classroom is that success is never final, nor defeat fatal. So long as you have the courage to act on principle and the decency to respect the principles of others, that's what leaders do. They stand ready to make the hard decisions and to live with the consequences, and they don't pass it off to somebody else. I'll tell you the final story about when Pat Nixon died. I called Senator McGovern. I said, George, would you like to go out with a delegation of the Senate to the funeral of Mrs. Nixon? And he said yes. And I was pleased that he said yes. We went there, and during the course of after the proceeding was over, and they had this terrible, terrible, nasty race in 72, and they were partisans, and they were adversaries, but at the funeral of his wife, Pat, in June 1993, Richard Nixon recalled how their first granddaughter, Jenny Eisenhower, had asked Pat how she would like to be addressed. Pat, through Grandma, sounded a bit old and decided on just Ma. Then Jenny put the same question to President Nixon, who told the little girl, "Oh, you can call me anything, Jenny, because I've been called everything." As laughter swept the room, I looked over at George McGovern, who at my invitation had joined the congressional delegation attending Mrs. Nixon's funeral. Like many of us, George was biting his lip to keep from shedding tears. Later in the day, a reporter asked George why he should honor the wife of a man with whom he had waged a sometimes bitter battle for the White House. You know what he said? He said, "You can't keep on campaigning forever. You got to bring an end. This is America." And he was right. There's a time and place for everything, including partisanship. Every 4 years, we stand in front of a mirror and ask what kind of a country we are and what kind of a people we aspire to be. And voices are raised, and sometimes things are said in the heat of battle that do little to reassure the friends of democracy. But passions cool, perspective returns, and the Dirksons and the Moynihans and the McGoverns and the Pryors turn away from the campaign trail to resume their pursuit of the public good. That's the kind of public servant we need. That's the kind I hope to expect will be the hallmarks of this school. America will demand something of you, and she will settle for nothing else. And to make that point to these guys who are here today, our honored guests, these World War II guys, remember on D-Day, the days leading up to D-Day, you couldn't see your hand in front of your face, the weather was so bad, and Eisenhower had to make a decision. And it wasn't about where we're going to meet next week, it was about life and death. Thousands would die, supposed to shorten the war, end the bloodshed, end the cost, And he had to make the decision. Every day they'd meet, May 25, 6, 7, 8, 9, June 1st, 2nd, 3rd, 4th, 5th. On the 5th, they were finally told that on the 6th of June, 1944, the skies would open up. And they tried to make the landing. Maybe some of you guys were there. One man had to make the decision. And it was an enormous decision that would change the history of the world. The story is, I heard it just 60 days ago from General Goodpaster, who worked for the Eisenhower family for 60 years. Said Eisenhower went off in a corner and put his head in his hand for almost 2 minutes. And in that two-minute period, he prayed that he would make the right decision. And then he made the decision and went back and prayed that he had made the right decision. And then he wrote out a little four-sentence statement, which I have a copy of, which is one of my prized possessions, to give the press in case the landings failed. And it went something like this. The landings have failed and I have withdrawn the troops. We acted upon the best advice available of all the experience available. The soldiers, sailors, everybody, every troop involved did all that devotion duty could call for. If there was any failure or any blame for the attempt, it was mine alone. Now, you want a lesson in leadership, young or old? We all make mistakes. We always want our children to be better. But somewhere Eisenhower learned from his mother or his brothers or at West Point that accountability is responsibility. It's a trademark. Eisenhower could have blamed a dozen other things, the weather, lots of things, coordination. But he understood if the landing failed, it was his fault. And the rest is history. We prevailed in World War II. The casualties were reduced. The bloodshed was stopped. The world had a chance with freedom again. At one decision. So that's a challenge you have at the new Clinton School. And one that I know President Clinton is going to be deeply and energetically involved in. So again, I'm very honored to come here on a Saturday afternoon when I know you got a lot of things you'd rather be doing. Maybe you're tied to your seat, I can't tell, or asleep. But I thank you very much, and God bless America.
Wow. Wonderful. That was really great.
I hope you're going to allow me one moment to tell these, especially these young people, a little story. I don't think this has ever been printed. I don't think it was in the book that you have written, Senator Dole. This is a story that really happened. I was in a small meeting one night. It was very, very late in the Senate, 12, 1 o'clock. We were rancorous. Partisanship was everywhere. We were mad, hungry, tired, supposed to be at home. Things were not going well with the Republicans nor with the Democrats. Senator George Mitchell was the Democratic leader. Senator Robert Dole was the Republican leader. We were sitting there trying to strategize, and we realized, you got him. Go get him. Cut his throat. Do it. And George Mitchell looked back and says, I can't do that to Bob Dole. And some to the Dole Institute of Politics, accept it with our very best wishes, Bob Dole. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
And And Senator Dole, Barbara and I never thought I would spend a whole afternoon shopping for a present for Bob Dole, but I did. Barbara and I did find something that we think is not only representative of, but gives you a little bit of the beauty of the state of Arkansas that you can take back to Washington or to Kansas or even to North Carolina, to Lydia's home. This is something for Lydia and Bob Dole from Barbara Pryor and myself. So please accept it with our love and affection to Bob Dole. Thank you very much. This is the Clinton School of Public Service. This school is about you. We want you to know that this is your school. We want you to know that you're going to be welcome there. We want you to know that there we're going to try to stimulate thought and discussion and debate. We also want you to know that we're going to try our very best to make you proud to say that Arkansas is home to the University of Arkansas School of Public Service. With your help, with your support, we're going to make it that way. We want to thank all of you for coming this afternoon. Thank you very, very much. Thank you, Bob.